This video will demonstrate the resection of a ruptured Spetzler-Martin grade 4 lateral frontal arteriovenous malformation. The patient was in her early 20s. She was traveling overseas when she developed an acute onset of headache and aphasia. She was found to have an intracerebral hematoma on CT scan. An underlying AVM was identified, and she was later referred to us 2 weeks after her ictus. On presentation here, she was intact. Here, her CT scan demonstrates this subacute hematoma in the frontal lobe. The CT angiogram shows an adjacent AVM at the posterior margin of the clot. The angiograms to the right show a tight compact nidus of AVM fed by a leash of lenticulostriate arteries that go to the tip of this conical AVM. The AVM had a Spetzler-Martin grade of 4, with 2 points given for size, one for deep venous drainage to the basal vein of Rosenthal, and eloquence next to Broca's area. The Lawton-Young grade was 2, with points given for age only. This grading shows that there is a mismatch between the Spetzler-Martin and the Lawton-Young grades. A left perioral craniotomy was selected. The patient position, skin incision, and craniotomy are shown here. Surgical strategy consisted of a left perioral craniotomy, splitting of the Sylvian fissure, preserving the arteriolized draining veins, dissection of large MCA feeding arteries going into the nidus, a cortical incision to evacuate the hematoma along the anterior margin, skeletonization of large middle cerebral artery trunks, occlusion of deep lenticulostriate feeders with coagulation or microclips, division of the main draining vein, en bloc resection of the AVM, and finally clipping of 2 flow-related aneurysms on the middle cerebral feeding artery. Here is a view of the lateral frontal lobe. The Sylvian fissure is seen at the top of your screen. The dilated veins are seen in the center with the frontal lobe to your right. The dissection begins in the Sylvian fissure. By splitting the frontal and temporal lobes apart, this dilated and arteriolized draining vein is seen. Working deep to the vein, these feeding arteries are identified. Here is the main trunk that feeds the AVM, and these branches coming from it are cauterized and divided. Next, the hematoma is entered, and clot is evacuated to decompress the space in front of the nidus. Here, the cavity empties out. It helps us to find this anterior margin of the AVM. Here, the draining vein is again seen. It is being followed out of the AVM in order to help identify the margins of the nidus. A plane is being developed here around the backside of the AVM. This artery had been previously embolized with glue. Here, as it's cauterized, you can see the glue within the lumen. Now, this posterior margin of the AVM is developed, taking great care to stay as far away from Broca's area as possible. Broca's area is immediately behind my bipolars, and therefore a very tight dissection is maintained here along the nidus. Now, deepening our dissection, we begin to encounter these lenticulostriate feeding arteries. They're very thin-walled and difficult to coagulate, but must be carefully handled, otherwise they can bleed profusely. Here the vein is followed deeper, and just underneath we see some additional feeding arteries. These feeding arteries are followed into the undersurface of the nidus, where they are coagulated and divided. Here I'm demonstrating the use of these AVM microclips on these thin-walled vessels that don't easily coagulate. The dissection now deepens, and we begin to get deep to the arteriolized draining vein. Here, this large trunk terminating in the nidus is cauterized and divided. Additional AVM microclips are being applied here. This is the territory where these lenticulostriates perforate the tip of the cone of the AVM nidus. Notice that the overlying draining vein has darkened. At this point, we can cauterize the draining vein and divide it. The AVM is now circumdissected and can be removed en bloc. The resection cavity is inspected carefully, and there is no evidence of residual. However, There are two flow-related aneurysms that were detected during the dissection. Here you can see one along a bifurcation of the middle cerebral artery trunk. A slightly curved aneurysm clip is applied here to obliterate this sac. A second, more distal aneurysm is seen here. This one is very broad-based and flat, but again, a slightly curved clip can be applied across its base to occlude it. Notice the thinning of the wall and that cherry red appearance of the sac. Here now is our overview showing the aneurysm clips, the resection cavity, and this terminal feeding artery that has been divided. This was an example of a lateral frontal arteriovenous malformation that sat immediately in front of Broca's area. Its proximity to language function makes the dissection particularly dangerous, and careful, meticulous technique is needed. Feeding arteries are typically from prefrontal, precentral, and central arteries, but in this case, they were mainly prefrontal. The patient tolerated the procedure well. She had no new postoperative neurologic deficits. Her postoperative angiogram was clean, and she was discharged home on postop day 3 with normal speech function. Here is her postoperative angiogram. Note the preservation of her middle cerebral artery trunks, and also note the preservation of the uninvolved lenticulostriate arteries. In conclusion, surgical resection is indicated for ruptured arteriovenous malformations in appropriately selected patients guided by the Lawton-Young and Spetzler-Martin grading systems. Supplementary grading identifies high-grade AVMs that are good surgical candidates, namely high Spetzler-Martin and low Lawton-Young grades in this case. The presence of a hematoma and its associated cavity facilitates AVM dissection and minimizes transgression of normal brain tissue. Lenticulostriate feeding arteries in the deep white matter may be small in caliber, but can be difficult to coagulate and control, necessitating the liberal use of AVM microclips. Thank you.